Welcome. Good to see you all today. I hope you had a good 4th of July and you're enjoying your holiday weekend. We have a few announcements before we begin worship. The most important announcement is that teen camp of Camp JYC starts today at 3 p.m. So we need y'all to please pray for the counselors. If you have any spare toilet paper around that you can donate, that'd be great. Preferably unused, yeah. We're really good on paper towels for now. We still need some more cookie bakers for our third week. Please see Marie if you can help out. She's back there in the pink shirt. Cookie bakers, can see you. And carnival is next Wednesday. We could still use some assistance with that as well. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. That's Wednesday the 17th for the carnival. And t-shirts are in. I know many of you are already wearing one. If you ordered a t-shirt, please see Loretta. They were $15 a pop. Please see Loretta on that one. If you are serving at camp this year and you weren't here for staff training last Sunday, there are copies of the staff training handbook and the code of conduct in the back. There's also a video recording of the training that we'll need you to watch in order for us to comply with New York State standards. So if you did not do that, please see Cassie. She will send you the link to the recording of last week's training and make sure that you get the paper signed. Like I said, we have to do this to comply with state standards. Each evening between Sunday and Thursday, we'll be holding Vespers talks, Vespers services, at 7 p.m. And you can join us for meals. Lunch is at noon, dinner's at 5:30. There's a suggested donation of $2 per person for the church family. And let us know ahead of time so we know how much food to prepare if you plan on stopping by for a meal. With any questions about that, you can see Miss Cassie or Mr. Martin today. With that in mind, we have a very special guest this morning. Mr. Dick Matthews, a longtime, very faithful missionary, and he's going to come up and give us an update on his latest mission trip. Sir, if you'd like to come up, you can use the pulpit if you would like. Yes, sir. You could if you like to, yeah.
It's great to be back and see so many new faces. Wow. I'm enjoying sitting in one of your new seats. It's sure more comfortable than the old pews used to be. To give you a very brief update, I have finished at the end of March 9 months at the Cambodian church in Danbury, Connecticut. Cambodian church, very small, ready to close, and God's been good. And they think they have found a permanent pastor. So I'm glad. And I'm doubly glad that I don't have to drive 602 miles every weekend now. After that, I went to Cambodia, 3 weeks in Cambodia, 3 weeks in Taiwan. The Cambodian trip was exceptional, very productive, and I just do not have time to share everything that happened. In Taiwan, where we lived for 10 years, I had the opportunity to spend that time, 3 weeks, with a couple from our church in Naples, and that was very enjoyable and productive. There are two things happened in Taiwan, very spiritual things. I hope you are able to tolerate this. I got to Taiwan 11 o'clock at night. I was met at the airport by Steve, Don, and his daughter. They were an hour late, and I was wandering around the airport for a while. And then we got to the hotel that he had arranged for. And I got settled, I'm used to traveling, and went to the bathroom and discovered in the bathroom something I had never seen before in my life. a heated toilet seat. Have you ever seen one? They're wonderful. And I found out that every hotel in Taiwan, it's a common thing. And I enjoyed it, and I appreciated it. And I spent more time there than I should have. But I shared this with my church in Naples. And they said, boy, heated toilet seat, nothing like that in Yates County, believe me. So on my 93rd birthday, 3 weeks ago, I was given a gift, and you can imagine what it was. I now am probably the only person in the whole county of Yates with a heated toilet seat. And the second thing that impressed me in Taiwan was this. We were taken out for a Chinese barbecue. It was wonderful. It was free to me. And you know how barbecues run. Every time you go around the thing, you get a new plate. And with the four of us there, the plates started piling up. And I said to the to Daniel Shen, my friend, can I sit on this thing? Yeah. I said, you know, this table's pretty small, and these plates are getting multiplied up here. What do we do? Oh, he said, no problem. He sticks out his arm, and a robot busboy comes tumbling down the aisle, stops at our table. We load everything in this robot busboy, punch a button, and the thing goes back somewhere. I thought, what country am I living in Yates County? Nobody ever saw a heated toilet seat. Nobody ever saw, in Yates County at least, a robot busboy in a barbecue restaurant. I'll tell you, we are living in a different age. One of the things that happened in Taiwan that I will share briefly with you is this. We lived in Taiwan for 10 years. Years and years and years ago. And in 1970, we built a 7-story concrete building in Taichung because the congregation had grown to that point. And we were enjoying our new building. And a missionary from South Taiwan, Ping Dong, stopped by one day and he said, Dick, he said, this is a great building. It's a ministry center in this populated area like this. He said, in Pingdung, we meet every requirement. But he said, I can't raise a dime. And he said, how are we ever going to get anything to build here in Pingdung? And I could see it coming. And he said, Dick, would you help us raise some money? He said, we need money to buy property and build a building right now while we're in the possibility of doing this. So the pastor in Taichung and I came to the U.S., started in Portland, Oregon, made our way slowly across the U.S. For 3 months, we raised $55,000. Went back to Taiwan. I gave the people in Pingdung the money, and they said, thank you very much. And then in 1972, my wife was diagnosed with MS, and the mission said, you got to come home. We can't treat that in Taiwan. So we came back. And that was 1971 or so, that era. I don't know how many years it is now. It's got to be 50 years or more. I never saw the land, never saw the building until this last trip. And this last trip, I asked Steve, who's starting a new work in Pingdung, city now of 1 million, and I said, is that church still around? You know, churches come and go, and they flourish, and they don't flourish, and whatever. Oh, he said, it's one of the biggest churches in town. So we went over, I saw the building, saw the land, met the pastor. We discussed he didn't know who I was. I mean, they've had umpteen pastors over 50 years. And we talked for a while, and when he figured out who I was, he said, "We just had our 50th anniversary, and you're in it." I said, "I'm in it." "Yeah." He said, "We made a book for the 50th anniversary, and we gave mention to you and Roger Lai coming to the U.S., raising enough to build our building. That land and property is located right across the main highway from the Pingdong Municipal Park. I mean, you couldn't buy that land today for $25 million. Literally. I'm serious. I hadn't seen it, heard nothing for 50 years, but to go there and meet the pastor and see a flourishing church in the middle of a city of a million people, I'll tell you, God is good. God, we don't have any idea of what we do today and how it will affect the future someday. Keep that in mind here in Franklinville, because what you do now will have eternal consequences. Thank you for your time. One of these times when I can get Mark to give me more time, I'll tell you more about Cambodia. It went really well. Okay.
At 91, he's inspiring, isn't he? Still going. Okay, our call to worship in Isaiah this morning, chapter 61. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He's covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its bud, as the garden causes things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all nations. Amen. Shall we pray? Father, thank you for your great blessings to us, for the blessing of seeing your work through the ages, and the blessing of seeing your work in our lives this past week, and even this morning, to see a beautiful day, to be able to enjoy the fruit of your blessing, your creation. Thank you for each one here this morning that you have brought together for the purpose of worship, the purpose of praising you, and the purpose of hearing your word. May it strengthen us, encourage us, challenge us, and equip us to serve you in this day and the days ahead. We ask your blessing on the worship team, your blessing on Mark as he shares your word, your blessing on these people that have decided to join with us. And we ask you to all in Jesus' name, amen.
We'd like to invite up the Blattner family and Mary Jo Wilder and Seth and Aubrey, if you guys can kind of gather in front of the communion table, please, along with Brother Mike and Brother Russ. We have the great privilege this morning of introducing to you, yes, everyone else can sit down. Sorry. We have the great privilege this morning of introducing to you these new members here at FBC. Over the past 4 weeks, we've met with them weekly, heard their heart to take a deeper step of fellowship here at FBC, and their testimony, their call to salvation, their desire to serve the Lord here, and we are honored to affirm them before you guys this morning. So I'm going to hand that over to Mike and to Russ.
Story of mercy and grace that you're writing on the hearts of these wonderful people that are now part of this family of faith called First Baptist Church Franklinville. Lord, help us to not only pray, support, encourage, motivate, but also pray for those who are standing here before us. May they know that we love them. We can't wait to see how you unfold your perfect story of mercy every day in their lives. Thank you, Father, for each family member. Thank you for the traditions that are here. Thank you for the people that are going to come after them as well, for the legacy of faith that they're living. May we just be a part of that as a family of faith. We love you, God. We thank you so much for this time and for these people, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen. I want to invite you to greet those around you this morning, but please make your way up here and welcome these folks officially to the church family. So you guys can't go anywhere. Come on up, greet your neighbors.
Okay. We're going to join in worship, so if you join us, stand and sing with us.
thank you for the privilege that it is to meet here today. Lord, thank you for the rejoicing that we can have for other believers around the world, Father, for the work that you are doing in other countries, Father, and for the work that you're doing in our own backyard. We pray, Father, for just a most incredible blessing this year during camp. Father, please bring many lost souls to you. Lord, not just the children who come, but we pray that it will reach into their families, Lord, and that you will do a great work in this community through the work that you already have going. Father, thank you that we get to be a part of this, and we pray that we will take this very seriously, Lord. Thank you for the time here this morning. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome. Want to invite you to open your Bibles, please, to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. We'll be in verses 1 through 5 this morning. Beginning in verse 1, I'll give you a moment to turn there. God's word says to us, "Finally, brothers, pray for us, that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored, as happened among you, and that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men. For not all have faith, but the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. And we have confidence in the Lord about you, that you are doing and will do the things that we command. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ." Let me read that one more time. "Finally, brothers, pray for us, that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored, as happened among you, and that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men. For not all have faith, but the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. And we have confidence in the Lord about you, that you are doing and will do the things that we command. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ." Now, this is a brief little interlude here over the course of 2 Thessalonians, the short letter. And what strikes me the most is how clearly you see Paul's heart expressed in these verses. You can really see his love for the church. You can see that he wants what's best for them. Another thing you pick up on here is that this church, the Thessalonian church, is a pretty good church. They're a pretty solid church. They're really encouraging to him. They've really been a blessing to him in his ministry. This was not the case for all the churches that Paul ministered to. Some of them were much more challenging. Some of them were outright very difficult to deal with. But that's not the case for the Corinthians, or for the Thessalonians, excuse me. Now, how do we know this? Over the course of the two letters that he writes to them, he never condemns them for anything. He never even really criticizes them for anything. In fact, aside from the parts where he's teaching them about doctrine, he's basically just commending them. He talks to them about the day of the Lord. He talks to them about the rapture. He talks to them about the man of lawlessness. He teaches them some doctrine. But when he's not teaching them doctrine, he's basically just commending them. He's telling them how good of a job they're doing. And to the extent that he's telling them to do anything, his only real instruction is keep doing what you're doing. So this is a church that was a serious blessing to him. They were the ideal model church. Now in these verses, here in verses 1 through 5, I see four commitments that any healthy church should make. Four commitments. So this morning, I want us to look at those commitments, and then I want us to spend briefly some time looking at a few things that can interfere with those commitments if we're not careful. My message this morning is entitled simply, "Making the Most Important Commitments." Making the most important commitments. Here's the first one. Commit to pray for the swift, effective spread of the gospel. Pray for the swift, effective spread of the gospel. And one of the things you notice in this passage is the great difference between these verses and the ones that came before them right at the end of chapter 2. Paul concluded 2 Thessalonians 2 by telling the Thessalonians that he was praying for them, and then by telling them how he was praying for them. by thanking the Lord for them and by telling them how and why he was thanking the Lord for them. And it's clear throughout his letters that it was a priority for Paul to remain in prayer for the Thessalonians. It was a priority for him to remain in prayer for all the churches that he ministered to. He's always praying for them. He mentioned it back in chapter 1 of this letter. He mentioned it again in chapter 2. Now, Paul's prayers for Christians were always very spiritual in nature. They were always eternal in nature. What's he not praying for? He's not praying for things that are material. He's not praying for things that are earthly. He's not praying for things that are temporal in nature. He's praying for things that are spiritual. He's praying for things that are weighty and earthy. Why was he praying like this? Because he knew the challenges they were facing. He knew what they were up against, right? They were in constant danger. They were being persecuted for their faith. They were being heavily mistreated for their faith. They were brand new in Christ, brand spanking new. Like, probably the most mature Christian of all the Thessalonians had only been saved for a few months. They were brand new to the faith, so they had a lot of learning to do. They had a lot of growing to do. And what adds to this challenge? They didn't have any established leadership present who could guide them in these areas. So he's praying for them consistently. If you compare the struggles that the Thessalonian church was experiencing and you put them up against the struggles of the average church today, it wouldn't even compare. Not at all. It wouldn't stack up whatsoever. They were going through things that could very easily crush almost every church. So he remained in constant prayer for them. Now in this passage, in these verses, what's he doing? He's basically doing the opposite of that. He said to them, I told you how I'm praying for you. I told you that I am praying for you. Now, here's how you could pray for me. I told you how I'm lifting your burdens before the Lord. Here are my burdens. Here's how you can support me in prayer. And you see that this is an element that's going to be present in every healthy church. What do I mean by that? The leadership and the church body have to be in prayer for each other. Not just the leadership praying for the church, not just the church praying for the leadership. In order for the relationship to work, in order for it to function the way that God wants it to, both sides have to be faithful in prayer for the other. There's a lot of stuff that you can be praying for the elders. There's a lot of stuff the elders can be praying for you. And if there's an imbalance there, then someone's not doing their job, right? This is probably the main application of this passage. And this gives us a window into Paul's heart. How does Paul want to be prayed for? How would an apostle want to be prayed for? How does an American Christian in 2024 want to be prayed for? How did an American Christian in 1800 want to be prayed for? How does an apostle want to be prayed for? Look with me at verses 1 and 2. Finally, brothers, pray for us. Here it is. That the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored, as happened among you, and that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men, for not all have faith. How does he want to be prayed for? Two things, right? He's praying that the gospel is spread effectively. He's praying that he be delivered from evil men. But the first concern that Paul has is for the spread of the gospel so that the Lord is glorified. More than anything else, more than any other concern, more than any other care, more than any other desire, he wants to see the gospel spread effectively. He lived for the success of the gospel. He lived and he died to proclaim the word of God. This is the thing that's on his heart the most. Pray for the success of the message as it goes out, wherever the Lord would have it go, wherever the seed is planted, whoever hears the word, whoever receives it, whoever listens to it, pray that it's effective as it reaches them. Pray that the word would speed ahead and that it would make progress, right? And he says, and pray that the messenger would remain faithful. Because what is the constant temptation when it comes to the proclaiming of the gospel? The temptation is to not be faithful to it. He says, pray that I be faithful. Pray that the word would speed ahead. We also see this expressed to the Colossian church. Look with me at Colossians 4, verses 2 through 4. Now, Paul wrote this letter, the letter of Colossians, from a jail cell. Here's what he says. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. You know, at that point in Paul's life, he's resigned himself to the fact that he's not getting out of prison. He's not even asking really to be taken out of prison. He's not asking to be delivered from that. What's he asking for? That it would be an open door for him to share the gospel. He's resigned himself that this is where he is. He's a prisoner for the sake of Christ. Let me share the gospel as faithfully as I can in that capacity. That's what he's thinking of. Over in Matthew chapter 9, Jesus commanded his disciples to pray with the same things in mind. Verse 37, then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Pray that God would send the right people to proclaim the gospel message to the people who need to hear it the most. This is what Jesus wants us to pray for, right? Now, you remember the second thing Paul asked the Thessalonians to pray for, that the gospel would be spread quickly and that he'd be delivered from evil men. He's asking for his own safety here. Now, I know that he's not asking for safety just for the sake of being safe or feeling safe. That's never been his concern. He put himself in unsafe situations for the gospel all the time, and he paid the price for it. What's he asking for? Keep me safe so that I can share the gospel. If my head gets cut off, there goes the gospel ministry. If I'm hindered, there goes the gospel ministry. Keep me safe so that I can keep proclaiming the word of God. This is what he wants them to pray for. Now, this is detailed for us all throughout the book of Acts. If you've read that, it's one challenge and one obstacle for Paul after the other. And then the Thessalonians saw this with their own two eyes. Now, where was he located when he wrote 1st and 2nd Thessalonians? He wrote those letters from the city of Corinth. And in the city of Corinth, he was going through much of the same stuff that he went through in Thessalonica. Much of the same instability, much of the same mistreatment, much of the same persecution. So he's asking that the Lord would protect him. So pray for the swift, effective spread of the gospel. Here's the second thing. Trust in the Lord regardless of our circumstances. Trust in the Lord regardless of our circumstances. He commands the Thessalonian church not only to be prayerful, he tells them to be trusting. Prayerful and trusting. Now you have to remember the challenge that they're facing and the challenge that Paul is facing, and I've said this over again, is that he's not there with them. And he wasn't with them very long before he had to leave. So there's this sense in which his ministry feels unfulfilled among them. There's this sense in which he feels like he's leaving things on the table. If it were up to him, he'd be there in person to minister to them, to teach them these things. He'd be there in person to teach them how to pray. He'd be there in person to show them what faithfulness looks like, but he can't be. He regrets this. He's basically saying in these verses, I can't ensure these things for you. I can't make these things known to you in a vocal sense. So instead, what you have to do is trust entirely in the Lord. This is in verse 3. Take a look with me here. But the Lord is faithful, he says. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. But the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. Why do we need to be reminded of this? Why is this something that has to be present in the mind of every Christian? Because if you're out there proclaiming the gospel, if you're out there living for Christ, if you're out there being the salt and the light, there's going to be a worldly price to pay for it. We know that you're going to get pushback about this. We know that you're going to come under spiritual warfare. We know that you're going to get pushback from Satan. You're going to get pushback from the unsaved world. There's a definite price to pay for openly proclaiming the gospel. You need the protection of the Lord. You need to understand that God is going with you. It's unavoidable. Now, I think we realize in the midst of our most difficult times that God is with us. I think we inherently know that we're supposed to be relying on the Lord. Why do I say this? Because you'll talk to Christians who are going through something, whether they're going through a diagnosis, a negative diagnosis, maybe they were diagnosed with cancer, or they're going through some major loss in their lives, or they're going through some major challenge. What do you often hear Christians say? They'll say stuff like, I don't necessarily know why this is happening to me, but I'm trusting the Lord. They'll say, I don't know why God is allowing this, but I know that he's faithful, and I know that he's going to bring the result that he wants. I've heard Christians say things like, this isn't a situation that I would have chosen for myself, but his ways are higher than my ways. Or this isn't a situation I would have chosen, but there's something that God wants me to learn through this. Inherently, we know that we should be trusting in God, and inherently, if we're truly saved, we do trust in God. Now, Scripture says this is one of the ways that you can know that your faith is genuine. What do you do when you encounter a crisis? Is your faith strengthened? Is your faith exposed as being genuine in the Lord? or when you encounter a crisis, do you crumble and do you walk away from God? So this is the purpose of trials and tribulations. They bring out these things so we can know where we stand with the Lord. Now, sometimes you'll see that our flesh creeps in, right? And we get tempted to not trust in God. We get tempted to trust in our own strength. We get tempted to trust in our own abilities. But we need to be reminded of the importance of this from Scripture. But here's the incredible thing. Even in the moments, Scripture says, when we're not faithful, God remains faithful, right? 2 Timothy 2, verse 13 says, even when we are faithless, he remains faithful. Why? Because he cannot deny himself, right? So God's not looking down from heaven and saying, FBC, you know, you were faithless one too many times. Mark, you were faithless one too many times. I'm removing your salvation from you. I'm removing your eternal life from you. He says, when we are faithless, he remains faithful. If he were to do otherwise, he'd be denying himself. He cannot deny himself. Now, Paul had experienced this reality and experienced this comfort in his own life many times. He knew the Lord's ability to strengthen him. Please take a look with me at 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13 here. 1 Corinthians 10, 13. He says, no temptation has overtaken you except that is common to man. But God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. I want you to think about the substance of that promise there. No temptation has overtaken you that is common to man. How often are we battling through something? How often are we struggling with the temptation or we're struggling with a sin? And our only thought is, no one can relate to me. No one knows how this feels. No one knows what I'm going through. No one knows what this battle is like. It says here, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. Whatever you're facing, other Christians have faced it. But what's the promise? But God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. He protects you. Now you say, is God sovereign over all this? Is God even sovereign over the things that tempt me? Is God even in control over the things that tempt me? Yes, he is. He sure is. And we need to recognize that to his glory. Even the things that tempt us, even the things that seem way too big for us to face on our own, and they are too big for us to face on our own, he's still in control of them. We have to trust him. If you ever needed a reason to trust him, right? He's in control even of the temptations you face. Here's the third thing. Remain obedient in all that God has commanded us to do. Remain obedient in all that God has commanded us to do. God's looking for Christians who are prayerful. He's looking for Christians who are trusting. He's looking for Christians who are obedient. And that's what Paul is emphasizing here. Now, you talk about commands and you talk about rules and we think, is he just coming up with this stuff? Is this just what he wants for the Thessalonian church? Is he just inventing these things because it's his preferences? No, what he's doing is he's passing along what he's received from God. He's passing along the divine revelation of how God wants his church to function. God's vision for God's church, God's design for God's church. He's used the Apostle Paul to teach churches of these things, including us. This is God's blueprint. This is God's design. Now, when we deviate from it, which we often do, we know that we're not leading ourselves to success, we're leading ourselves to failure. Look with me into just verse 4, please. And we have confidence in the Lord about you, that you are doing and will do the things that we command. You are doing and you will do the things that we command. He has confidence in the Lord regarding the Thessalonians. Why does he have this? Why does he have this confidence? It's because of what he's already seen from them. He's already seen their willingness to listen, their willingness to follow. He's already seen that they're open to teaching. He's witnessed that they prioritize being obedient to the Lord. Every piece of evidence indicates that this is where their heart is. And he knows that this is going to continue because they were a real church made up of real believers. Their faith was the real deal. Why is this important? They've obeyed in the past. They have a habit of obeying. And he's confident that they'll continue to obey, so he can commend them for that. I'm confident in what the Lord is doing for you. Basically, what he's saying is, when I asked you to pray, when I told you what I needed you to pray for, I knew that you were going to pray. Have you ever shared a prayer need or a prayer request with a fellow believer, and the reason you shared it with them is because you knew that they would bring it before the Lord? you knew that they were going to be faithful in carrying out that prayer request. I want us to be the kind of Christians that when you hear a prayer request, stop what you're doing and pray with the person right there. For me, the biggest reason I do this is because it doesn't give me a chance to forget. If you ever tell me something and I don't write it down, I might as well have not heard it. Seriously. So if you come to me with, I need prayer for this, I'm probably going to stop you and we'll pray right there because there's a good chance I will forget if I don't pray with you right there. If I pray with you there, we're good. But he's confident they're better than me. He's confident that they're going to pray. He's confident they can share these prayer requests. And the thing that holds this together is their obedience to the Lord. An obedient heart is one of the most important things that a church can possess. If you can think back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 1, he praised them for this. Take a look with me at verses 1 and 2. He said, finally then, brothers, this is back in the last letter, we ask and we urge you in the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the same language that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and to please God, just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus. He's saying, you receive from us how to walk. You're walking in that. Keep walking in that. Because you can have the best intentions. And you can have the best doctrine. And you can have the best ideas and all the best information. But if you're not obedient to it, if you don't actually put it into practice, what does Scripture say? Scripture says, you're deceiving yourself. Be doers of the word, not just hearers. You have to put into practice the things that you know. It requires obedience. Here's the fourth thing, the final commitment. Progress in growth towards spiritual maturity. We're looking to be prayerful. We're looking to be trusting. We're looking to be obedient. We're looking to continue making progress. Now, even though this is mentioned last in the passage, it's no less important than the ones that come before it. Look with me at verse 5 here. Now, may the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Now, this is a really interesting desire that we see captured here, expressed in this verse. I don't think I've seen this phrase anywhere else in the Bible necessarily. I don't think I've seen it anywhere in the New Testament. But Paul is saying that because of the Lord's faithfulness and because the people of the Thessalonian church were genuinely converted to him, he expects that they're going to be all right. He expects that the trajectory they're on is going to continue. There's no reason to think that. But he wants them to continue the spiritual growth that they've started. He's asking the Lord, Lord, open this path for them that you want them to go down and then strengthen them to go down the path that you direct them to go, right? The most important thing is to keep moving forward. For any church, for any organization, really, the most important thing is to continue making progress. You never want to become stationary. You never want to become stagnant. The most important thing is to keep moving forward. We need to have constant movement in the direction where God has called us. We need to constantly be going down the path that he's laid out for us. Go deeper into God's love, and you will love him, and you'll want to love him more and more. That's pretty much what spiritual growth looks like in the nutshell. Now, in the Bible, we talk about churches and we talk about growth. We need to understand that spiritual growth is really the only kind of growth that God is concerned with. The New Testament doesn't say a whole lot about numerical growth for churches. It doesn't say a whole lot about a church growing their building or their property. It doesn't say a whole lot about a church growing their budget. God is always looking for churches to grow in spiritual depth and in spiritual maturity. That is far and away the growth that God is most concerned with by far. He's looking for churches to be more mature. He's looking for churches to be more obedient. He's looking for churches to be more loving. Now, a church may grow in those areas, and it might lead them to numerical growth, but even if it doesn't, he's looking for increasing faithfulness. That is growth in the eyes of the Lord. Now, it's heartbreaking to think that many churches never really experience that for themselves. You might even say the majority of churches are not experiencing greater spiritual depth. Imagine that you see a church and you're among them and they're at one spot and then 5 or 10 years later you see them again and they're in the same spot spiritually. It's heartbreaking to think. Now, in the meantime, maybe their influence grew. In the meantime, maybe their reputation improved. Maybe they became more beloved by the community. But spiritually, what happened to them? There are huge mega churches that are well known with really great reputations and really popular names that have no spiritual depth. And then there are small churches that are almost dismissed by the world that are very spiritually deep. If you had to pick which one is more pleasing to God, he's looking for spiritual depth far and away over anything else. We see a similar command here in 1 Peter 4, verses 1 and 2, please. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. That is spiritual growth. That is what Paul longs to see in the lives of these people. Live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. Who could ever possibly say that they've mastered that? Who could ever possibly say, I'm no longer living for human passions, I'm just living for the will of God? Anyone who tells you that they're perfectly fulfilling that has misled themselves. There's always room for progress. There's always room for improvement. Now, I want us to spend just a couple minutes here as we close looking at two things that can get in the way of these commitments, two things. Now, there are any number of things that can actually get in the way of this. I want us to look at just two of them. And I think these are two pitfalls that any church can fall into. This can happen with old churches, it can happen with young churches, it can happen with new believers, it can happen with people who have been saved their whole lives. I think every church has to be on the lookout for these. Here's the first one. Elevating other things over the gospel. This can interfere with any commitment you make. Elevating other things over the gospel. From the outset of the church, back in Acts chapter 2, from the very first meeting of the Christian church, we see that the gospel is front and center in everything that they did. They proclaimed the gospel boldly. They suffered for the gospel. They shared the gospel with everyone they knew. And when they gathered around, it was centralized on the gospel. Why is this? Because our relationship with the gospel, whether we embrace it or whether we reject it, is the most important aspect of who we are as people. There is nothing more important about you than your relationship to the gospel. Those who embrace the gospel, we know that the blessing of that is eternal life with Christ after this. Those who reject it, eternal punishment. There's nothing more important about you than where you're spending eternity. That's more important than who you choose for a spouse. It's more important even than how you raise your children. It's the most important aspect of who you are by far. The gospel is the entire reason that the church exists. It's the reason that we're called Christians, because we've embraced the gospel of Christ. Look with me into 1 Corinthians 15 here, verses 3 through 5. For I delivered to you as of, underline this, first importance, what I also received. That Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. What's he saying in this passage? It's the importance of the gospel message. First importance. There's nothing more important than that. There's nothing more foundational than that. But there are many churches today that I fear you wouldn't even know that by looking at the way they function. If you looked at how they did things as a church, if you looked at their worship service, if you looked at how they were organized, you wouldn't know that the gospel was front and center. In fact, there may be many things that they put before the gospel. It might be that the gospel is just a sideshow. What can churches elevate over this? We saw last week, they can put traditions over this, right? People can elevate their preference for music over this. They can elevate certain ministries over the gospel. None of these things are a bad thing in and of themselves, but they're not the point of the church. They're not the reason the church exists. Those things are only helpful and they're only useful to the extent that they further the gospel message. They can get in the way of the gospel if anything is put over the gospel. We need to be reminded of what God has done for us. Now remember what Paul said to the Thessalonians. He goes, the reason I'm so glad of who you are is because when you received the gospel from us, you received it how? In full conviction. You received it with power. You received it with the Holy Spirit. They are who they are because of how they responded to the gospel. We are who we are as a church and as individual believers because of how we respond to the gospel. Now, my main concern with many Christians today is I think we almost take this for granted. I think there are many Christians out there who could not explain to you the gospel message if they were asked. I think there are many Christians who could not take Scripture and show someone from Scripture how they can be saved. And that's a concern. When things are elevated over the gospel, this is when you see division, it's when you see idolatry, it's when you see meaninglessness. In Galatians, we see that the church was starting to get confused over the gospel message. They'd become misled by various false teachings. Look with me at Galatians 5, verses 7 through 9. You were running well, he says, verse 7. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Verse 10. I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view, and the one who is troubling you will bear the penalty, whoever he is. You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? You were prioritizing the gospel. Who stopped you from doing that? You better eliminate it. Here's the final thing. Second thing that can interfere with this is becoming complacent in our spiritual growth. Becoming complacent in our spiritual growth. Kind of saw this in the text this morning. One of the keys to remaining faithful to a church's commitments is that the church realizes that there's always room for growth. There's always room for improvement. We're never as faithful as we can be. We're never as obedient as we can be. We're never as loving as we can be. This isn't a condemnation of any church. It's certainly not a condemnation of you. It's just the reality. We're, the church is made up of imperfect people. Myself, yourselves, we're imperfect. We still sin, right? So anything that we come together to associate with is going to be imperfect, which means there will always be room for improvement. We have to realize that. Even if a church has improved, even if they're in a different, better spot than they were in the past, there is still room to keep pushing forward, and we have to keep pushing forward. If we get prideful, we start to think that we've got it all figured out, we fall short of the mindset that God has called us to. Now, I say complacency, right? Being stagnant, being comfortable with where you are. And the problem with comfort is not that's not bad in and of itself, again, but it can lead you to complacency very quickly. There's a very short and quick path from comfort to complacency, and you have to eliminate that. When we become complacent, we are of very little use to the kingdom. It's almost impossible to effectively serve if you're really happy with where you are. Again, think of the command that Paul gave to the Thessalonians. You have these great qualities. You're loving, you're faithful, you're obedient. You excel in these areas. You excel to the point that you're the model church for other churches in the region. You've really figured it out, but I want you to excel even more. I want you to do even more. I want you to do it even better, and I want you to keep doing these things in the future. Don't be comfortable with where you are. Look into Revelation chapter 3 with me. And we're looking at verses 14 through 17. These are the words of our Lord Jesus to the church at Laodicea. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea, write this: the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works. You are neither hot nor cold. Would that you were either hot or cold. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I'm rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. Is that something you ever want to hear the Lord say about a church that you're part of? I'm going to read this again. I know your works. You are neither hot nor cold. I would that you were either cold or hot, right? Because then you'd be of some use. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I'm rich, I've prospered, I need nothing, not realizing that you are actually wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. Right? This is what spiritual complacency does to a church. I have it all. I've got it all figured out. I'm prospered. I'm rich. Let's make the right commitments. And I want us to encourage each of us to look inside of ourselves. Is there anything inside of us that we need to eliminate? Is there anything inside of us that we need to get rid of that's keeping us from making or carrying out the commitments that God has called us to? Be prayerful, be trusting, be obedient, keep making progress towards spiritual growth. Let's close with prayer. Father God, we love you. We thank you for the clear commands that you've given the church here in 2 Thessalonians 3. May we be more obedient to them, Lord. May we follow them more closely. May we never elevate anything over your gospel message, and may we never become spiritually complacent. Lord, you've put before us this month an incredible opportunity for ministry. Help us to put in the work necessary for this to be a fruitful season for the church. Help us to put in the work necessary to reach those who are coming to camp and to bless them with the gospel message. We thank you for the time and the energy that's already been invested, and we pray that your blessings would be on those who have made those sacrifices. Continue energizing and inspiring people for the work that lies ahead this month and into August. We thank you for this opportunity, and we realize it can only be successful if we faithfully apply ourselves and pursue you. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Gentlemen, if you'd come forward for the Lord's Supper. Thank you. We're now going to partake of the Lord's Supper here at Franklinville FBC. We do this monthly. We invite you to join us on the condition that you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and that you are actively seeking to follow him. You don't have to be a member of this church. You don't have to be a member of any church. You just have to be an active believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the only condition that we see outlined for us in Scripture. We're going to give you a moment as the elements are being distributed to go before the Lord in prayer and to confess anything to him that you may be holding back right now, whether it's a secret sin, whether it's some bitterness or hostility that you're holding on to, directed at another Christian. This is a chance to confess it to the Lord and receive a clean slate before partaking of the Lord's Supper. On the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and he said to them, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of the sins of many. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the Apostle Paul is making clear this doctrine for the Corinthians. And he says that every time we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he returns. So you don't believe the Lord's Supper has any power to save you or to wipe your sins away. That's only done by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But it's done as a memorial to Jesus' work on the cross. And through that work, we can stand before God justified and forgiven. So I encourage you to reflect on that today. I encourage you to reflect on that every day. Let's open with a word of prayer. Father, as we come before your table, we ask that you would convict us, that you would correct us, and that you would encourage us, Lord. We thank you for what we are remembering today, Jesus' saving work on the cross, his death for our salvation. Please be with us now, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of the sins of many. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Would you stand and join us as we close with a song today?
Son.
Doxology from Romans 16. Now to him who is able to strengthen you, according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, and according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith, to the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. If you'd like to head up to camp today, check-in is out 3. You can hang out. It's always great to have some more smiling faces pointing people in the right direction. So feel free to show up at any point, help out. 3 p.m. Thank you.